When you're writing your screenplay, you don't want to have to think about formatting. Final Draft 11 automatically paginates and formats your script to industry standards, allowing writers to focus on what they do best, writing. Final Draft, used on 95% of all productions, contains many features that make your writing process easier and more efficient. Final Draft, the number one selling screenwriting software worldwide, also offers the Final Draft mobile app for iPhone and iPad, making creativity truly portable. Bring your story to life with Final Draft 11. It all starts with a script.
Fight the industry, because there is a, especially in the creative fields, you know, there's a non-seriousness which women are looked at.
But what will be going live now?
Sure.
Hi. We just saw The Disguise and The Autumn, directed by Sandeep Verma and Saurabh Kumar, respectively. The screening of The Disguise was cut short due to some glitch, and we're still working on it. You can watch the film on Hotstar or Pocket Films. Moving on, we have a panel discussion on portraying women on screen authentically. We were supposed to have Saurabh Kumar and Sandeep Verma, both of them, for the discussion, but unfortunately, Saurabh Kumar had some personal emergency and he won't be joining us. We're glad to have Sandeep sir here with us. Thank you, Sandeep, for joining us. Sandeep Verma is an Indian film director and writer who stands out for his impactful work. He is also a co-founder of Film Board Movies. He has also done some short films such as Street Children and Water Conservation. Though he is best known for Majnunath, a biopic based on a true story. So Sandeep, starting the discussion, I would actually want to know that why did you choose this genre? Like there are so many things. You had such different movies which you made earlier, The Virgins. So why did you choose to make a film on this genre?
Well, actually, to be honest, there is a writer, Riya Mukherjee, who's an old friend of mine from Delhi, and she is actually not a professional film writer. She works a lot in radio. She's one of the big names in radio, and she's very interested in cinema, and she's been my friend, and she has been telling me that I want to write a script. So basically, she's in Delhi and I'm in Bombay, and she used to keep sending me ideas. Out of the various ideas which she had, she sent me this one as a premise, which I liked for the kind of thought she had. You know, it was talking about something very big in the softest of ways. So I generally like subtlety in cinema. I don't like very loud cinema. So I thought that idea was nice. Then I encouraged her to write the full script, and she wrote a draft, and then we worked on it. And I thought the script that turned out was pretty interesting, enough for me to tell her that, okay, let's do it now. So that's how it evolved. It's a very organic process. It's not that, you know, just one day decide to make a film like that. It's something which you deal with your creative team.
Okay. That's great, actually. Your film, it's a personal narrative, right? It is an intimate experience about the lives of two women. So what difficulties did you face while drafting a personal narrative which you might haven't faced?
Yeah, see, firstly, the two main protagonists were women. Okay. Yeah. And I have no doubt in my head that I'm not a woman. So the one thing which I could be arrogant about many things, but the one thing which I am not arrogant about is not to pretend to see. One can understand a different gender, but to feel like a different gender is a little more difficult. So there's a difference between understanding someone. You can understand a friend, but to feel like that friend is a little different. The first thing which I did is the shortcut is to, I already had Priya Mukherjee was the writer. Then I surrounded myself with women. So my associate director is a lady called Jaishal. Then our line producer in London is a lady called Nancy, who's actually from India, but she went to London for this. And your biggest assets when you do a film like this is your actors. So the way I see the way I make films is very collaborative in nature. So I call the script primarily a proposal, which then you farm it out to your creative team, and a critical part of your creative team is your actors. So once I discussed the character and the script with Naomi and Adriana, the two lead actors, they had a lot of inputs as to how they would feel in that situation. And then we kind of kept on morphing the scenes as per, you know, in a very subtle manner, as per how they felt through it. So it's not, I mean, this is just the way I understand cinema is that it cannot be like a director tells everyone to do something and then they do it like robots. It has to be a collaborative process where the director says, this is the script, this is what I want to do in the scene. It gets back to you as to this, I think can be done better this way. And then you incorporate those suggestions into the way you shoot the scene. So actually, I didn't find it that difficult considering I had such great assets like the two main actors, like Rhea, like Jaishal, all these other women around me. So I kind of took the backseat on this and I said that, okay, let the women play on this.
That's great. Actually, I love the film. So
thank you.
I could see how thoughtful process it would have been because, you know, everything, I loved how the trauma, the triggering part, the water gun, it was water gun and nothing big, because trauma doesn't necessarily come from some big actions. It can be from very small things that happen around you. Very small things can be triggering to your trauma. So yeah, I really love that part. What is portraying women on screen authentically to you? Like, as a male director, what do you consider your responsibility when you're portraying two women protagonists?
Yeah, so I see, I would not go so specific on gender because, you know, each woman is different. So you can't really generalize women as you can't generalize men either. I do feel that there are differences in the way different people look at the world. So one can generalize a little bit as to how a woman would look at a certain situation and a man, typically a man would look at a certain situation. So for me, that was important to capture, you know. If a woman takes off her burqa and comes out, so for me, if you remember, I don't know how many of the audience could see the full film, but there's a shot in which Rabia, Naomi, played by Naomi, first time takes out the burqa and comes out of her house. Okay, so the how a woman is looking, the appreciation that she needs, first time coming out in public without her burqa, would I thought factor more for a character like Rabia, who's otherwise a little shy, a little reserved as a person, also because she's a woman. So that's why, you know, if you remember that when she comes out and her and the door closes, there's a wide block shot which I took, which was to show her solitude. You know, she's alone, a single figure against that big house and the surroundings. So it's a way you, as a director, you play and tell the audience how she's feeling. So all cinematic shots about how a character is feeling need not be about looking into close-ups and looking into characters' eyes. Sometimes you can play with the atmospherics. From the woman's point of view, it was important. She's a social person, Rabia. She comes out, the lady in the neighborhood who's gardening. Possibly her husband might just walk through in any case, and not greet that person every day. But she's a social person and she likes to, talk to her neighbors as she's talking, say her greetings. And so these small things looked at it with a magnifying glass, what the effects this was having on her. So when the neighbor does not recognize her, it's something which could possibly happen only to Rabia.
It even happened at the time when she was picking up her order.
Yeah, correct. So, that guy, she has been picking up her breakfast order every day, maybe for the last 4 years. And that guy's only seen her eyes, and till now. And so when she enters the cafe, I don't know if you remember, there's a shot where she pauses there. And then when we charge the camera to her close-up. And that's deliberately taken because what I told Naomi during that shot is that she asked me what exactly do I feel at this stage when I enter into the cafe. So I told her that, listen, this guy's your friend, you know someone for 3-4 years, every day you come, sometimes you talk with him, he's your friend. First time he's going to see you without your burqa. So, a friend who you like and he sees you first time, you are actually in anticipation as to whether there will be approval of the way I look. So there's a bit of nervousness in her expression at that point of time, which is why we pause the camera there just to hold on to that expression for a bit. These are small things which to me were specific to Rabia being a woman. The film is actually that way, coming back to what you were saying earlier about the violent act which happens at the bus stop with her, which is simply with a water gun. But violence is in the head, it's not necessarily with guns. So what we wanted to, at a broad level, apart from the issue of identity, it was also about, all these world politics which is happening and the events in the world. And we read about all of this stuff in the news and, this terrorist bombing happened and stuff. It is actually percolating into the minds of people, like a virus. And it's affecting not just human beings, adults, but also children. So what I liked about the premise is that those children, are not taught to go and shoot a water gun at something. It's something which must be happening at the breakfast table at home, this kind of discussion about ISIS and stuff like that. So whatever they can process, they have processed. And then trying to actually look at a very big problem in the world about how our opinions about certain races change in the most microscopic way, how it affects the normal lives of normal people was what the disguise to me was all about.
Even I saw some of your interviews. So there was this one interview with Times where you said the movie is not about Islamophobia, but about the identity. That cleared out. So I wanted to know, does the film address the concerns of a woman's bodily autonomy? Because, both the women in some way were pressurized. The first moment she was pressurized that, in peer pressure and in cultural ways, she should not be wearing a burqa. Even her boyfriend suggests that you should burn this. And the other woman, she also faces challenges. She's contemplating herself whether she should be more of a believer. So do you think it's the film addresses to the issue?
Exactly what issue are you talking about?
Bodily autonomy, what you should be wearing and what you should not be wearing. Women face this pressure all the time.
Yeah. So, I have my own observations about the wearing of a burqa by a woman. But the thing is that it's also at the end of the day an individual choice. There is a lot of... in this case, these characters were actually dealing with what? Let's understand that. What happens in a big city, and that's why we wanted to shoot in a large metropolis, is that So I don't know, Himanshi, for example, whether you are, which part of the country you belong to, your ethnicity. Okay, I do not know. So as in your ethnicity, as in your parents, grandparents, that kind of thing. So what happens is our ethnicity starts, we need to start dissolving it a little bit in a large city to be able to fit in and not have rough edges. And the question always becomes, and then we go back home every day. And our parents and our grandparents, you know, make us sit through the prayers and then make us go through certain rituals and wear certain things on festivals and stuff like that. And then we are constantly pulled back to what we call the roots. So the challenge in a large city becomes how much of the roots to retain and how much of the roots to give away in the effort to fit into the larger, because when we go out of the house, then we are dealing with all kinds of people. It doesn't happen. I mean, strike that as different from what happens in, let's say, a village where everyone is from the same ethnicity. Everyone talks the same language. Everyone pretty much has the same kind of food and wears the same kind of clothes. And, you know, there is a cultural mooring in a village, which is very specific to the village, to the area. Whereas in a city, everyone brings their own value systems, which arise from their roots. So in India itself, it's a huge thing. You know, I mean, the way a Bengali will eat and a Gujarati will eat and a South Indian and a Kashmiri. So, and more so in when you talk about an international multiracial city. So the struggle for us, for Rabia and Lena, these two characters, was basically to depict. So Rabia is struggling to hold on to what she considers the last moorings of her roots in a city like London. So she's become westernized. And, you know, in her habits and in what she probably eats, and she probably keeps away from alcohol, you know, and so this is a burqa for her is a symbol that I am still holding on to some of my roots. Okay, and why her partner discourages her and keeps saying burn the burqa is not actually to make her get rid of the burqa, because he's only worried that today it's a toy gun, tomorrow it might be a real gun. So why do you want to rub people the wrong way? So he's actually more worried about her safety, because he knows that sometimes a burqa is a symbol to people, to the stuff which is happening in the Middle East and, you know, the terrorist bombings and stuff like that, that there's an intolerance which exists actually in the Western world. So he's a little worried on that front. I'll tell you an incident which happened while the shoot was on in London. So Adriana, the girl who plays Lena, is originally from a very small country in East Europe called Moldova. But she stayed in London for a long time now, and before that she was in Italy. So she was arguing with me while the shoot was on that, you know, just because if I wear a burqa doesn't mean that people will, you know, look at me in a different way. And I kept on arguing back. So I said that, listen, I have not stayed in London as long as you have, but I know this, that their opinions about you will dramatically change. Now this argument went on, and then there's a shot in the film where she's wearing the burqa for the first time and she's walking towards camera, and that shot in which the heel breaks, if you remember that shot, you know, her heel breaks. So we had placed the camera, and she was walking next to a wall, and she was waiting for us to call her to walk towards the camera. And next to the wall was a parking lot. And while she's waiting there, there's a car which enters the parking lot, and the guy actually stops the car, pulls down the glass, and abuses her because she's wearing a burqa. Okay, and she's shocked. Okay, and this happened live in front of us. And then of course, Adriana is a feisty character. She gave it back to him. But then later on, she acknowledged that, you know, I was a little right about how people perceive people. So they are struggling to either hold on to their cultural moorings or let go of it, which is the different struggles between Rabi and them. So that's why we talked about identity. They're trying to hold on to whatever identity they feel they have from their ethnicity. But they're also struggling to try to fit in into a large city like London. So So that's the whole play.
Even my parents, everybody, I think this is the case with everybody in every part of the world, because my parents also keep insisting me how I should, you know, be more culturally, be more religiously interested, and it's just hard. Also, true, it'll all just be very simple if every one of us was more acceptable and more considerate and more empathizing towards other people. The incident you told is just, you know, sad. It's just sad. And it happens to so many people around the world at all the time. Okay. Moving on to the next question. What process or experience? Okay. Yeah. I read your movie, this film was partly crowdfunded and, you know, self-funded. So what were the process or experience crowdfunding your film and locating it outside India in terms of technical aspects? What was the process and your experience?
Okay, so firstly, let me just clarify this, that the full credit for this film getting funded in the first place belongs to Riya Mukherjee, who is the writer and producer. So she's one hell of a gutsy woman, so when she actually sent me the script finally, so then she said ki karega kya, karega isko, main kya karunga, producer kaun hai, paise kahan hai, and she had placed it in London. So I said that listen, I mean it's going to be expensive, it's not going to be easy. So then she went around and so what happens with indie films typically is that and it was a first film and you get a lot of what is called the first film luck. So she also, I mean, she went around with a begging bowl actually to all her friends and family. And then she put this up on a platform called Crowdera, I think, where she got a lot of people contributing to, because people were reacting well to the premise. Some bit of credibility came because my name was attached to the film. And she never, I mean, not once did I see Riya pull back from saying, "Acha London mein hi karte hain, Bombay mein karte hain," and all that. She wanted it to be the best it could be. So I mean, it was a fairly long process of getting the film funded. And even then, when the full funds had not come, then Riya said, "Okay, let me put the rest of the money myself." So it's a great lesson for people, because I kept on telling Riya that, I mean, I was just only responsible for encouraging her you know, pushing her into the pushing her off the cliff, as she may put it. So I kept saying Karle, because see, for me, I have done this before with my film Manjunath, which was a feature film, which was crores. So for me, the experience, I think, which Riya would have gained, the sheer pleasure of having the script which she wrote, with the premise which she felt so strongly about, come out and get lauded in hundreds of film festivals. That premise is priceless. Uske liye agar thoda sa mehnat karke, thoda khud ka paisa dalke, doston se bheek mang ke, agar hota hai, it's fine, you know, it's absolutely fine, because otherwise she would just spend those 3 years, you know, trying to, you know, work with corporates and earn more money. I mean, that's little more, this is far more interesting. So the full credit belongs to her, and I'm sure she had a lot of pain through it, and she didn't tell me half of it because she wanted to keep me away. She kept saying that I don't want to bother you, because I was supposed to focus on the creative process and, you know, cast the actors. And I mean, the other challenge was we didn't have enough money to go twice to London. So there's normally a recce which you do, where you go and look at the locations, you select the cameraman, you select the actors, do auditions. So all of this we did online. In fact,
on Skype.
Yeah. So the cameraman I selected in London is a young guy called Ezequiel, of Spanish origin. So very talented young cameraman. He actually went around various locations and sent us videos, which I could then, you know, select which location works, doesn't work, stuff like that. So it was, I think what happens is when you have less money but a lot of spirit and passion, there is far more cooperation and collaboration which happens than if you have a lot of money, because then people are just working for their fees. In this case, Everyone knew. So Ria did make sure that she paid everyone, you know, whether it's full fees, half fees, whatever. But everyone knew that the pain she is going through in setting up this film. So everyone wanted to come forward and help, because it's a great script which she had come up with, great premise, something important was being said. So in the film, so I think that created, you know, being on the back foot like that created a lot of spirit of cooperation and collaboration.
So even, you know, I can totally understand not exactly how Ma'am Ria would have felt, but even in our projects, in our festival, we had to get sponsorship. So solely on the basis of what you're planning to do, on the basis of your script, it would have been very difficult, because everybody asks, what do you have to offer? Like, do you have a face? Do you have, what do we benefit from it? So it's very tough. So we'll just open the floor for live discussion now.
Sure.
Q&As. Okay. So, I also wanted to ask, I was reading about your education background. So you had done an MBA, and before that you did your engineering. So how did you end up into filmmaking?
So in fact, I've done my MBA from Delhi University, FMS, your university, and engineering from Bispilani before that. So, I mean, I'm from the same kind of background that all of you are, where, you know, parents have expectations, and I was decent in my studies, in the sense that I don't know how much I learned, but I used to have a knack of scoring marks. So I got into good colleges, and then I got into good corporates. Like, I worked with Devers, ITC. But somewhere, you know, something was missing for me. As I was telling you before this session about last year's pandemic, similarly, for me personally, what had happened just before, while I was in engineering, was I had some kind of kidney problems, because of which the doctor said I may not live in the next 15 days. So that actually got me thinking that, you know, all the plans which I had made as a young man, you know, main ye karunga, phir ye karunga, phir itne paise kamaunga, phir world travel karunga, stuff like that. They actually of no use. You don't have much of a horizon on life in any case. In the same way as I was talking about the pandemic last year, a lot of people have realized that, you know, suddenly something like this can happen, and, you know, the whole life can change after that. So that was my mindset. While I was doing well in my jobs after MBA, I kept on feeling that, am I just going through the rat race and not being satisfied? I did have a writing passion since childhood. So I used to write, but mostly on the sly, as a hobby, because I was too shy of showing it to anyone, because I thought there'll be disapproval. Because, you know, my family consists of mostly the engineers, doctors. There are a lot of doctors in my family. There are a lot of IAS officers are there. So those are the respectable professions. You know, if you are good at anything, you better ya to ye teen char cheez karo ya abroad jao. So
sure, most people who are watching this will relate to whatever you're saying.
So this concept of safety was there, but I kind of said that I'll just do what I want to do. So I just
take it. It's great, actually. I really hope that people, you know, get the belief that they have. I really hope that people can build on that belief and they can go and follow whatever they want to.
Yeah.
It's a bit scary, but I think, I really hope it's worth it. That you do not go later in your life, like I personally do not go later in my life and think, should I have done this? Had I done this? Or, you know, all those thoughts.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's come to the questions now. We have this question, Rohan. He's asking, sir, is film school necessary?
So, I mean, if you want to be a filmmaker, I would say film school is not necessary, but it helps. What film school gives you is two things. One is some level of technical training, which means that you know how the camera, the film equipment works. You know where to place the camera, stuff like that. The other thing which it does is it gives you exposure. So you study with a peer group, so you meet other people who are interested, so you can get driven by their passion as well. You learn how to work in teams. But I would say that, I mean, the way I learned, I had done too much of education for me to then go into film school after that. But, you know, the best school is the work itself. So I assisted a director. And I would still recommend that's the best way. The girl who's working with me for the last, like I said, 12 years has never gone to film school, though she's from art school, but she's never gone to film school. And she's all set to launch as a director this year. So, but she's worked with me on all my projects. And when you work with a director who's a little senior to you, who has a little more experience, then you not just understand the technicalities because he knows better than you, but also get the most important thing for a filmmaker is to have an independent opinion. You see, all the stuff which is happening around us socially with relation to whether it's politics, race, gender, all of these things, there is very important for young people coming up to have opinions about it. Now, someone may agree or disagree with you, but having a clear cut what I feel about gender, for example, okay, is something which is... So the reason I think Ria contacted me with the disguise was because she knows my opinion on gender. She knows my opinion on women and I the way I think they are treated and the way they are objectified and stuff like that. So I think that is something which you can't get in a film school. So that you can get with working with someone who's a little senior to you, who will help you process what is happening in the world for you. And slowly you will get confident of your own opinion, because you keep arguing. Because all my assistants, I always encourage them to disagree with me. I don't want assistants to agree with me all the time. So you tell me where I'm wrong, I'll argue back, and we have healthy and long discussions. And we sometimes fight, we sometimes don't talk to each other for 2 days after fighting. But it's very healthy because it's a lot of argumentativeness which is happening, which leads the younger people to also formulate where they were, you know, little misplaced, where they were rightly placed. So the forming of the mind is the most important thing, which can only happen whether you do film school. Even after that, you will have to, you should be working with a director if you want to be a filmmaker. Of a director whose work you like, may not be a big director, may not be a very famous director, but you should see the director's work, because with the director's work, you can figure out what kind of person he is or she is. So that is absolutely mandatory. Now, whether you do film school or not, then it also becomes a question of cost. Unfortunately, in India, there aren't too many good film schools. I used to like FTII, but it's gone into problems of late. And the others are not anywhere close to world class. So now the issue is, if you can afford it, then you go to Europe, go to Prague, go to London, go to New York or Singapore if you can afford less. But it's still it's bloody expensive. So agar paise hain to karo, nahi paise hain to nothing to feel that I can't be a filmmaker. You can always approach directors who are, if as long as you're willing to work hard, as long as you're willing to take some risks, if you're not going to ask for too much, it's not a corporate job, so the director won't be able to pay you how a corporate job pays. As long as you're willing to slum it out for a couple of years of your life when you're young, you should be able to do that. Obviously, you need to then, some of you will have to fight it off with your parents. But that's, you know, part of life, you know, I mean, parents are actually in your interest. So it's just that they're not sure. So sometimes I've seen people, young people, men and women, be shy about telling their parents what they really want to do.
Yeah,
but you know,
they just want us to walk a very secure path that pays us well. you know, that settles our lives for once and for all.
Yeah, but I think parents are also, I think parents get less credit than they deserve. A lot of parents have seen if the son or daughter goes to them and says that, listen, dad, or listen, mom, I really want to do this. Give me 2 years. I want to try this out. And I really, really want to do it. They're not your enemies. Most of the parents will tend to say, ki yaar, agar main na bolunga, to ye frustrated hoge, 2 saal mein wahi karega jo main bolunga, but you know, the person is not going to do well. I may as well give this person a chance. There are so many stories like that. So it's also about you, how much you are able to take the story to them. You know, if you're not sure about yourself, then you'll never be able to. So you need to be sure of yourself that way.
Okay, so next question that we have is, what will be your suggestion to a person shooting his first film?
I don't know what kind of suggestions are sought here. My thing is that before you even talk about shooting, work and work and work on the script. So absolutely be sure of the script, and I always recommend people to bounce off the script, narrate the script to as many people as you want. Try to catch, if amongst your friends, yes. Amongst other family members, yes. You don't have to follow their suggestions, but you will sometimes get to know from a layman's point of view where the script has flaws. It doesn't work. And if you can catch hold of, like I said again, write to good directors and say, can you read my script, please? A lot of them, if they have the time, then they like to encourage young people. There are a lot of young people who approach me and ask me if they can pitch their script to me. So as long as they're not expecting me to put money behind it, sometimes if I have the time, I just, takes 1 or 2 hours to read a script, you know, so I just read it and I send them back my feedback, what I think about it. It's up to them to incorporate. But work on the script a lot, because once you go on the shoot, it becomes very expensive to change anything. And 50% of your job is done if the script is great, you know, and even if you go wrong in the shoot a little bit, it's fine.
Just have one more question then. This is, what is the most important film of your life? And are you currently working on any projects?
Yeah, so the second part is, yeah, I'm working on 2 web series, which I've got signed on for. So both are very interesting stories. It's stories which I like I said, I work very hard on script. So these are stories which I've had with me for some time, and during last year's lockdown, I kind of fine-tuned it. So I really worked hard on those scripts, and then a couple of very big OTT platforms have taken a liking to them. One is an espionage thriller web series, which will come on one of the bigger OTT platforms. Probably once the lockdown in Bombay ends, then we'll probably start shooting that. And the other is a very interesting, it's a love anthology about something similar to The Disguise, except that it's about young people liking each other from different backgrounds, and then what happens. So one is a little funny, the latter one is a little funny, the first one is a hardcore thriller, with a lot of, so very excited about these things. I like you said earlier, I also have a startup called Filmboard, which is the reason I'm mentioning that is because a lot of people are actually getting opportunities through Filmboard. You know, the problem of access, you know, if you're sitting in Delhi or Hyderabad or Kolkata, even Bangladesh, problem of access to big directors or good projects or get opportunities, even as an intern, is the problem which Filmboard is trying to solve. So that's something which we are setting up. There's a lot of technology behind it. So that's also something which keeps me busy. The favorite film, I don't know what they mean, whether they mean favorite film which I have. I would say the favorite film which I have, amongst the favorite films of late that I've seen, I'm a big fan of Christopher Nolan. I really like the way, because what I like about Christopher Nolan is that he doesn't show his technique. So there's a lot of technique there are a lot of directors who tell you that, listen, I'm moving the camera now, or I'm putting the camera under the seat and see, this is the shot. Whereas with Christopher Nolan, the story is primary. And even a film like Inception, it's the most subtle kind of treatment which he will do. You'll never notice the treatment, but it's there. Or Interstellar. So big fan of his. Of course, everyone's favorite is The Godfather. It's the Bible of filmmaking, in a sense. In India, I still hark back to the days of Gurudutt. I think Kagaz Ke Phool is one of my most favorite films. There have been some very interesting work done of late in India. And a lot of it is in non-Hindi cinema. So some really good Marathi films I've seen of late, and there are some good films from the South which I've seen. So I do follow stuff from around the world. So these are some of the interesting things which I've seen. But I generally like films or any audiovisual content which makes me discover something about myself. I think as a filmmaker also, that's what I'm searching for always. You know, when I pick up something to do, by the end of that project, I should have learned more about myself. I'll give you an example. I did a short film called Kahani Baar with Ashish Vidyarthi, which the act of domestic violence against a kid, which I wrote in that, and then I shoot. And when I was shooting that, I realized that I have been witness to that domestic violence, you know, in my neighborhood. So as a child, so it was a kind of those memories of mine as a child had remained with me, and they came out after so many years in a film. And when it came out, only I realized that I was writing that, you know. So in a way, it was like a cleaning of my system. So I mean, that's what I enjoyed.
That's great. Let's just conclude with that, because we are running out of time. And sure. It was great talking to you. We have learned a lot, and I'm sure the audience too. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you to everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, and all the best.
Thank you so much.